Welcome back to your free Windows 7 training series for the 7680 exam. In this video, I will look at authentication and authorization in Windows 7. Authentication in Windows is essentially proving you are who you say you are. Once Windows has established who you are, you can then access resources on the network and the local computer. Deciding what you have access to is called authorization. Authorization is basically the process of deciding what you have access to once you have been authenticated. You can see that to be authorized to access anything, you first need to be authenticated. Think of the process being like a security guard standing at the front gate of a film studio. The actors are identified at the front gate and allowed access to their trailers and the set. The workers are identified and allowed access to the set. A general member of the public is identified and sent on the free tour around the studio, but not given access to the set or trailers. In the computer world, the person needs to be identified before they are given authorization to access anything. If they can't be identified, they will be given anonymous access if it has been configured. Windows has a number of different authentication systems that can be used to identify who you are. The first is Kerberos, version 5. Kerberos is named after the three-headed dog guarding Hades from Greek mythology. It is a ticket-based system which can be used to authenticate both users and computers. A ticket is mathematically time-consuming to generate, but can quickly be verified to be authentic once issued. Once a ticket has been issued, the ticket can be used to provide access to another system on the network. All the other system has to do is check that the ticket is valid, which is a fast process when compared with generating the ticket. Kerberos is the default system of authentication used in a domain environment. For it to operate, it requires a trust relationship to exist between the computer and the domain. When you add a computer to a domain, this trust relationship is created automatically. Next, there is NTLAN Manager, or NTLM. As the name suggests, this authentication method dates back to Windows NT. NTLM uses a challenge response authentication, the idea being that if you are who you say you are, you should be able to answer this. Generally speaking, Windows will ask the other party a mathematical question that can only be answered by using the password. This way, the password does not need to be transferred over the network. NTLM has been updated and improved since the Windows NT days. But you may be wondering why would you still need it when Kerberos is the default authentication system used in Windows. Kerberos relies on a trust relationship between the domain and the computer. There are a number of cases when Kerberos cannot operate and NTLM is the next best option. If the client computer is using an IP address to authenticate rather than the computer domain, Kerberos cannot be used. Also, if the computers are in different forests that do not have a Kerberos-compatible trust between them, NTLM will be used. If either of the computers is not in a domain, Kerberos cannot be used. And lastly, if any of the ports required by Kerberos are blocked by a firewall, NTLM will be used. The next kind of authentication that Windows supports is certificates. Certificates use public and private keys in order to encrypt information traveling across the network. With Windows Server, you can deploy a Microsoft Certificate Authority or use a third-party certificate authority. Windows 7 will support certificates generated from either. One use of certificates is in smart cards. The smart card has a chip inside which holds the certificate, the idea being that you cannot authenticate on the network without the smart card. The problem with this approach is that if someone were to steal a laptop with the smart card still in it, they could access your network without needing a password. To get around this problem, smart cards often support what is called multi-factor identification. Multi-factor identification is when you require two or more authentication methods to access the network. With smart cards, this is usually a PIN. If the laptop were stolen, then the thief would not have the PIN and thus could not use the smart card to access the network. Smart cards can also be used to encrypt hard disks and encrypt network traffic. They are not limited to only user authentication. The next type is biometrics. This includes fingerprint readers and eye scanners often seen in the movies. Using biometrics, the system can identify the person from their physical characteristics. This covers all of the different ways you can authenticate on Windows 7, or in simple terms, Windows can identify who you are. Once you are identified or authenticated, the next stage is authorization. Authorization, put simply, decides what you can access. This is normally done through three different systems. First, you have permissions. Permissions are assigned to a resource such as a file and determine what the person can do. Common permissions are read and write. Next, you have policies. Policies are assigned to a computer or user through group policy. They determine if something is available, for example, if the user can access the control panel or change the wallpaper. Lastly, you have rights. Rights are assigned to the computer. This determines what actions the user can perform. An example of a right is being able to log on to the computer. You either are allowed or are not. Another example is the take ownership right assigned to administrators. Regardless of what permissions are assigned to a file, administrators can take ownership of that file. Why? Because administrators have the take ownership right assigned to them by default. This may seem like a lot to know, but Microsoft has made it easier by creating built-in groups. Built-in groups have permissions, policies, and rights assigned to them by default. Microsoft has gone to a lot of work to create groups that most users will fit into. This list does not contain all the groups on a Windows 7 system. However, this list does cover the most commonly used by the network administrator. The first group is the administrators group. This is the most powerful group on the system. End users should not be placed in this group. Common practice on large networks is to log in as the administrator when you need to perform administrative tasks. When not performing administrative tasks, then a normal user account will work fine. The next group is the backup operators group. Members of this group can read any files on the system. The general idea is that users in this group can perform backups and restore files. Users in this group cannot change permissions on files or perform other administrative actions. The next group is event log readers. Members of this group can read the event logs on the computer. If you are using software to download logs from a remote system, you could put the users that require access into this group. This prevents them from having access to other parts of the system. The next group is network configuration operators. Members of this group can make changes to network adapters and network connections. It may seem strange having so many groups that don't provide a lot of access, but remember that group membership is accumulative. For example, a general user does not have access to change network adapters on the computer. If you want to give them this ability, simply add their username to the network operators group. To give all users on the system the ability to change network adapter settings, add the users group to the network configuration operators group. This gives you an easy solution to giving users more access without having to make them administrators. The next group is the remote desktop users. If you want to access your computer from remote using remote desktop, you need to be a member of this group. The exception here is administrators. Administrators, by default, have access regardless of whether they are in this group or not. If you want your users to be able to connect via remote desktop to the computer, you would normally add the users group or domain users group to this group. The next group is the power users group. This group was present in Windows XP and later removed in Windows Vista. In Windows 7, it has returned for backward compatibility. It is recommended that you do not use this group. If you do use this group, It is designed to give more rights than the user group, but less rights than the administrator, so it falls somewhere in between. The problem with adding general users to this group is that they also get access to certain system files and settings which the general users should not have access to. In Windows XP, it was common practice to add users to this group in order to get software to work. With Windows 7, I would try the other compatibility options to get your software to work and only add users to the Power Users group as a last resort. The next group is the Users group. This group is recommended for the average user. When in this group, the user can make changes to system settings that only affect them. They can also only read system and program files. Users cannot change settings that affect the entire computer. It is recommended that the general user be put into this group. The last group is the guest group. The guest group is usually only used on kiosk-style computers. Users in this group have limited rights which basically allow them to use resources and run programs, but not make changes. This covers the basics of authorization and authentication. I will now switch to my Windows 7 computer to demonstrate how authorization and authentication works in Windows 7. The first feature I want to look at is the Credential Manager. The Credential Manager allows you to save username and password in a vault, which saves you from being prompted for them later. To open Credential Manager, first open the Control Panel, and then select User Accounts and Family Safety. From here, select Credential Manager. To demonstrate how credential managers work, I will attempt to open a server on the network. You will notice that I am prompted for a username and password. From the Credential Manager, if I select the option Add Windows Credential, I can add a username and password for this server. Once the credentials are added, if I now open the server again, this time I will not be asked for a username and password. Using the Credential Manager, you can also add usernames and passwords for later use. The usernames and passwords you use in Credential Manager can also be backed up. If I now go back to User Accounts and Safety and select User Accounts, I can configure user accounts on this computer. On the far left-hand side, you will notice the option Create a Password Reset Disk. If you forget your password, you can use this disk to get back into Windows. Once I select the option, the wizard will start in which I will need to select where to save the password information. It is not safe to save the information on the hard disk, so Windows gives you the option to save only to the floppy disk or a thumb drive. Once you select your drive, the password information will be saved. This can later be used to reset your password if you forget what it is. This covers the basics of authentication and authorization. In the next video, I will have a closer look at how certificates work in Windows 7. For more free videos and free exam resources, check out our website or YouTube channel. Once again, thanks for watching.